Well, good morning and welcome to First Baptist Church of Mishawaka, Indiana. This morning I want to read for you from Ephesians chapter 4. I, therefore, a prisoner for the Lord, urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. This morning, as we sing and recite the Word of God to one another, we're doing so to build each other up in the faith and the unity of the gospel. So let's turn to the Lord now and ask for His help in doing this. Father, I pray that You would give to us Your grace as we seek to build each other up by singing together the truths of Your Word, by speaking Your Word as we recite Scripture, by listening to Your Word as it's preached, by joyfully giving to support the work of Your Word. May You be glorified this morning. May we be built up. May we be unified around the thing that matters, the gospel, and the task that You've given to us as Your people. And may what is done here spur on the work of the ministry around Mishawaka, in our country, in the world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I ask you to please join us in standing together as we sing, "Oh, How Good It Is."
Acceptance of God. you would please come forward for the offering this time? As they come forward, if you would, bow your heads with me as we pray. Our Father, Lord, we are thankful for the opportunity to worship you. Lord, I pray that during this time, that our hearts would be in tune with your Spirit in our lives. Lord, I know that your Spirit longs to work in our lives and to, Lord, make alive the Word of God as we read it. Lord, I thank you for the preaching of the Word that we're about to hear, and I pray that we, Lord, would be, Lord, submissive, Lord, to your Word in our lives. Lord, I pray that as we continue living our lives, I pray that, Lord, as one voice, we would cry Jesus as Savior in our workplaces, to our family, to our friends, and that's what we would be known for most. Lord, I pray that as we, Lord, give gifts to you right now, I pray that, Lord, as we use them, Lord, it would be a blessing to those and of service to those in need, Lord, to further the gospel, Lord, in the world, but also, Lord, in our immediate community here of Mishawaka. And it's in the name of Christ I pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Please join us for a time of worshiping the Lord through our singing and by standing. Each and every Sunday, we rehearse together truths about who God is, what He has done. This morning, the choir has sung together of the deep, deep love of Jesus. And this morning, if you're struggling to believe that, let's declare together, this is our God. He loves us. He's proven it by sending His own Son to die for us. So let's sing together, He is our God. Salvation, my fortress, I shall not be shaken. On God rests my salvation and my glory, my mighty rock, my refuge is God. Trust in him at all times, O people. Pour out your heart before him. God is a refuge for us. Selah. Those of low estate are but a breath. Those of high estate are a delusion. In the balances they go up, they are together, lighter than a breath. Put no trust in extortion. Set no vain hopes on robbery. If riches increase, set not your heart on them. Once God has spoken, twice have I heard this, that power belongs to God, and that to you, O Lord, belongs steadfast love. For you will render to a man according to his work. Fully dependent on God, our creator and sustainer, let's sing together a familiar hymn, I Need Thee Every Hour. Thank you. are the creator and we are the creatures. No one ever created you. You have always existed. And yet we had a starting point. And each and every breath that we take is provided by you. We are dependent upon you. I pray that we would at this time recognize that dependence, submit ourselves to you in worship, realizing that this week, whatever hopes and dreams we have, nothing happens if you don't allow us to pursue those things. This week, when we're tempted to doubt, when we're tempted to wonder whether you love us, help us to remember the gospel. Help us to remember that you gave us a new birth. We are your children, and furthermore, your sons and your daughters, with an inheritance that we've only begun to take advantage of, that is awaiting us for all eternity. Father, I pray that as we recognize you as the author of our salvation, the perfecter of our faith, you would give to us the ability to encourage one another this service as we have some, that we would remind one another in the times of trial that you are good, and that your purposes for us are good and for our benefit. I pray that as our pastor comes and preaches your word to us, you would give him boldness, you would give him clarity of mind and speech, and that you would furthermore clear our minds, allow us to be able to focus and to learn and to grow. May your Spirit use your word to change us into the image of Jesus Christ this hour. And may you be glorified through that and through the declaration of your saints that you alone are God. No one created you, and you deserve all of our worship. And the only way we can come to you is through Jesus. And we pray to you through him. Amen. If you're able, will you please join us in standing once more as we sing, God, you are the uncreated.
The author of salvation.
this time, children who are in junior church may be dismissed.
If you would take your copy of Scripture, our reading this morning will take place from Colossians chapter 4. Colossians chapter 4, we're going to be reading verses 7 through 9. Colossians 4, 7 through 9. Tychicus will tell you all about my activities. He is a beloved brother and faithful minister and fellow servant in the Lord. I have sent him to you for this very purpose, that you may know how we are and that he may encourage your hearts. And with him, Onesimus, our faithful and beloved brother, who is one of you, they will tell you of everything that has taken place here.
Excellent singing this morning. It was just a great time of worship. As you can see, we are coming to the end of Colossians. I mentioned that the last few weeks. The last 12 verses of this book are a bunch of names, some of which are really hard to pronounce, some of which you probably have not heard much about. I was really debating on how to handle this portion of Scripture, and really there's a few different ways I could have done it. I thought about doing it all in one week, but that's way too much to attack in one week, and so I could have done it where I went over a different name every week, but we would be here for the next few years doing that. And I didn't think we should do that either. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to handle verses 7 through 9 today and then finish up the book, the letter, next week. And so next week's going to be full. There's going to be a lot in there. But I want to look at this section, verses 7 and 9. And the reason I divided there is because 7 and 9 is Paul telling the people that he's writing the letter to about the people that brought them the letter. He's introducing them, so to speak. And then the rest of the chapter is Paul greeting those that are in Colossae. And so there is a distinction there between the two of those. Now, communication in our world has changed. I'm not pointing anyone out, but even as we were praying there, someone's cell phone rang. I'm not asking you to raise your hand, just asking you to turn it off. But someone's cell phone rang, and Bert turned to me and said, "Spurgeon never heard cell phones when he was preaching." Truth, right? Communication has changed. Let me do just a quick informal survey. How many of you in here do not remember a time in your life where the cell phone didn't exist? In other words, you have your entire life has been lived in the cell phone era. How many of you would be that? Your entire life has lived in the cell phone era. That's all you know. It was a few of you. Okay. How many of you remember a time when the phones had cords? Okay, it was some of you. How many remember a time when the thing that you listened to and the thing that you talked into were separate? How many remember that time? Some of you. Okay, how many remember the time of the telegraph? I mean, it was before the phone, okay? My kids think that's what I'm from, is that time, but I am not. Communication has changed. Paul wrote this letter 2,000 years ago. He lived in a time when communicating with someone was extremely difficult and usually meant a journey of some kind. I mean, think about the evolution of communication. I mean, prior to 1844 and the invention of the telegraph, if you wanted to get a message to someone, you had to physically send them a message, meaning either you had to physically deliver it or you had to hire someone to physically deliver it. And then along came the telegraph. The telegraph was an interesting thing. It allowed for electronic signals to be transmitted through a code from a written message over long distances. The first landline or telegraph line that was completed was in the U.S. in 1861. And then the first transatlantic cable, which was a big deal, was in 1866. These were huge developments. For the first time, you could communicate. Now, even though you could communicate, it was limited to one message, and you had to write the message and then code it, and then send it, and then decode it, and then write the message down before it could be delivered. So it wasn't really a simple process. Alexander Graham invented the telephone in 1876, and for the first time ever, a voice could be transmitted electronically. In 1877, there was 3,000 phones in the world. 3,000. Now, that number grew rapidly. I said 1877. By 1900, there was 1.4 million phones. So in just 23 years, it grew pretty rapidly. The first phone line across the ocean was completed in 1915, and then that allowed for people to communicate all the way around the world. Over the next several years, the phone has developed, and you can see here the different types of phones that some of you look at and say, yeah, I remember that, and some of you look and say, I have no idea. Remember those rotary ones? Okay. I talked to someone there the other day who didn't know what those were. But then in 1977, the first cell phone service, it was just an experiment, but the first cell phone service began to be tested. Cell phones today dominate our world, don't they? It is estimated that 5.1 billion people own a cell phone. That is roughly 66% of the world. I've been in various parts of the world. I remember being in a house in India where it was nothing more than a simple shack. And they had 3 cell phones in the house. That's the world we live in. You communicate through cell phones. And now, even today, with the blending of computer technology into a cell phone, it allows you not only voice, but text and pictures and video and even internet. And you can do anything on your phone, almost. And all of this technology has shrunk the world we live in. Communication has gotten much easier. I remember when I was a kid, our church did it, and I don't remember if any of you remember doing this in your church, but our church did a Christmas in August. Basically, what we did was it was a Sunday school thing where we were collecting gifts and presents, and we would write letters to our missionaries, and we had to do it in August because they wouldn't get it by Christmas if we didn't do it in August. I mean, today I can take my phone right in front of you here and send a message to our missionaries all over the world in seconds instead of months. It has changed. And when Paul wrote this letter, he didn't have that. He didn't write just a simple email. He didn't send a text message. And so I believe because communication was harder, he put more thought into it. And he put a lot of thought into this letter to Colossians. We've talked all about what he put into this letter. But after writing the letter, now he had to get it to him, didn't he? Now, he could have delivered it himself, except he couldn't because he was in jail when he wrote it. He could have used the postal service. There was a postal service in the Roman Empire. I don't know if you know that. There was a postal service. However, it was notorious for being they were very strong on filtering mail. And so he was probably concerned with that. And so Paul needed to have it personally delivered. And that's where we come to our message for today. This part of the book is a little different than the rest of the book. It's not to say it was written by someone different. It's just we need to handle it different. The rest of the book that we've read to up to this point in Colossians, Paul is clearly trying to teach the church something. In this passage here that we're going to look at today, he isn't technically trying to teach anything. He's trying to inform. He's trying to introduce to them 2 individuals that they may or may not know well or at all. He's trying to introduce, but I think from this passage, there's a lot of lessons that we can learn today. And so I think that's why it's valuable for us to go through it. And so let's look at these particular lessons. Paul is sending these 2 men, and for both of them, he commends them for their character. And I want to look at some lessons we can learn from them. The first guy is a guy by the name of Tychicus. Now, I'm going to get this out of the way. Tychicus is a hard one to say, number one. Number two, there are multiple different ways that people say it. Okay, so if you say it Tychicus or some other way, so be it, okay? I'm going to say it Tychicus today, and after a while, that's a hard one to say, so I might from time to time even say T, okay? Just so you understand what I'm talking about, okay? But what do we know about Tychicus? We actually don't know a whole lot about this guy. Okay? His name is mentioned 5 times in the New Testament. Now, it could be that they're 5 different guys, but we believe it's the same guy that's mentioned in those 5 different references. And so as we take those 5 references and put them together, we actually begin to develop a character of a guy. We first meet him in Acts. See, Paul was in Ephesus, and many scholars believe that it's possible that Tychicus grew up in Ephesus. We don't know that for sure. Some translations say that he was Asian and referring to Asia Minor, and some believe that specifically he was probably from Ephesus. Other translations actually say he was from Ephesus, and so not completely sure, but there is an idea that he's possibly from Ephesus. Well, Paul was in Ephesus near the end of one of his missionary journeys, and his plan was to return from Ephesus to Jerusalem. See, in Jerusalem at that time, there was this huge need. The people in Jerusalem, the Christians in Jerusalem, were facing persecution, and because of that, there was a huge physical, financial burden. And so the churches in Asia Minor had collected some money, and they were going to send Paul back. And so Paul, what he wanted to do was he wanted to take some of the Gentile believers in Greece and in Asia Minor as representatives to the church. And one of those individuals he took was Tychicus. And so he took Tychicus with him. Now, just even the fact that he was willing to travel with Paul shows a lot about this man. This journey from Ephesus to Jerusalem would have been a difficult journey. Travel in the ancient world was hard. It was obviously more difficult than today, but it was also more dangerous today, and the trip would have been very, very difficult. And along the way, repeatedly, Paul was told not to go to Jerusalem, because when he got to Jerusalem, he was going to face problems. And Tychicus would have heard this over and over again, and yet he chose to go. He traveled. Now, as Paul is writing Colossians, this is now 2 years later. After Paul went from Ephesus to Jerusalem. And in those 2 years, there would have been a lot that would have happened. See, Paul did go to Jerusalem, and Paul did get arrested. And he was there in Jerusalem, and he was facing trial after trial. And then eventually, he got sent to Rome. And even his journey to Rome was a trial, a shipwreck, and all these things that took place. Now, we don't know for sure, but it is possible that Tychicus traveled with him. We don't know that. We do know he was in Jerusalem because Paul took him. We do know he was in Rome because Paul mentions that, that he sent him. And so it is possible that he traveled with him, or at some point he traveled there. But the point is that he journeyed to Rome to be with Paul. In Titus, there's an interesting reference to Tychicus. Paul is writing to Titus and saying to Titus, "Hey, I want you to come visit me. I haven't arranged all the details, but I'm going to send someone to replace you." And one of the individuals that he considered to send to Titus, to replace Titus in the church in Crete, was Tychicus. It's interesting, we keep seeing this guy's name pop up, and every time Paul's giving him responsibility. At the very end of Paul's life, during his last imprisonment in Rome, the Bible tells us Tychicus was with us, and Paul is getting ready to face execution. And he writes one of his final letters, which is 2 Timothy. And when he writes to Timothy, his desire is, he's so close to Timothy, Paul wants to see Timothy one more time. And so in the letter to Timothy, Paul says to Timothy, I want you to come to me. But Paul did not want to leave the church where Timothy was at, which was Ephesus. Paul did not want to leave it without a leader. And so he said to Timothy, "I am going to send Tychicus to replace you." It's interesting again. Every time we see this guy, he's serving faithfully. So we come to this letter written to the Colossians, and we find Tychicus in Rome with Paul. And because Tychicus had proven himself faithful over and over and over again, Paul decides to assign to him a very important task, and that was to deliver this letter to the church at Colossae. Now, in the process, Paul also wanted him to deliver the letter to Ephesus, to the Ephesians, but it's also possible he also delivered the book of Philemon, which we'll get into more later. This trip to Rome would have been a challenging one. He would have had to by foot walk across Italy. It would have to hop on a boat and sail across the Adriatic Sea, and then on foot again cross Greece, and then hop on another boat and go across the Aegean Sea, and then by foot again across to Colossae. I went on Google Maps to see the distance. It's about 1,300 miles. It would have been a journey. I mean, you know, we walk 3 miles around the River Walk, and I'm ready to sit down for a while. This guy took a journey. But let's go back to Colossians. That was all introduction, because I wanted you to understand this guy, Tychicus, but I want you to see, more importantly, what Paul says about him. Because Paul then begins to commend this guy. Now, what I want you to remember is this guy is not some apostle or some massive missionary. He's just an ordinary guy. But yet, I think he's relatable to us. And I think we can see that God expects us and God desires for us to follow the example of a guy like this. So let's see, what does Paul say about him? First of all, he says in verse 7, Tychicus will tell you all about my activities. And then he describes him with three characteristics. He is a beloved brother, a faithful minister, and a fellow servant in the Lord. I want to look at four characteristics that I believe Paul gives here about Tychicus that I think is important for us to understand. The first one is, and I want to relate it to not just to Tychicus, but to us, because I believe all of us, this should display who we are. These should be characteristics that could be said about us. A servant of God, which all of us are called to be, is loved and loving. Now, I've said this numerous times, but Paul had never been to this church at Colossae, and it is possible Tychicus hadn't as well. Now, maybe he had. He grew up in Ephesus, and so maybe at some point he had traveled to Colossae, or at least was familiar with the people there. But either way, Paul was, by writing this letter and by writing this section, was in a sense endorsing Tychicus. He's trying to tell the people, hey, this is a guy that you should listen to. He's a guy worthy of your respect. They would have respected Paul, and so he wanted them to understand that. And so he says these statements. First of all, he says he's a beloved brother. What does that mean? Well, beloved means simply very much loved. It's not just simply that he's a guy that's kind of liked. No, he's very much loved. It's the idea of one's heart in tune with another's heart and cared for deeply. It was often used in the Bible of relating to fellow believers in love. And it's interesting, it's the same word that's used in Matthew chapter 3, verse 17, when Jesus is being baptized. Remember that? And after Jesus is baptized, there's a voice from heaven that says what? It says this, this is my beloved son. In fact, God is talking about Jesus there. In fact, the first 9 times that word beloved is used in the New Testament, it is all a reference of God to his son Jesus. So we see when Paul uses this word, there is some serious understanding that what he is saying here is precious. That it's precious. He also calls him a brother, though. He says, you are my beloved brother. Now, as if beloved is not enough, he tacks that on because there's a close association there of brothers. And we see that oftentimes in the New Testament. And even today, we will reference that idea of a brother or a sister in Christ. And that is the idea of what he's getting across here. Paul is telling us that he loved this man very much. But there's more to it than that. Because I want to read a little between the lines and understand the other side of it. That not only was Tychicus loved, but I believe Tychicus was a very loving guy. I mean, how many people would say, yeah, sure, Paul, I'll deliver a letter 1,300 miles. Unless, number one, he had a love for Paul, he had a love for the Lord, and he had a love for the people. He knew this letter was going to mean something to the church. He knew this letter was going to impact the church. And so he said, Paul, I'll do it. I'll deliver this letter. He was a guy. He was a servant of the Lord. And being a servant of God, every one of us should be people who are loving of our fellow believers. Do you love your fellow believers? Can you say about the people in this room, they are beloved? Can you say that about those in this auditorium, that you love them dearly? Paul described Tychicus as being a person who was loved and loving. But secondly, a servant of God is faithful and serving. Second, he calls him, if you look in the passage, he says, a faithful minister. Now let's divide that up again. Faithful means trustworthy, dependable, reliable. Faithful is someone that is bound to a pledge or a duty or a strict obligation that says, I'm going to continue this over and over again. And I want to pause right there and ask you, are you a faithful person? Are you a person that can be trusted on? I think we've lost that in our culture today. I think we talked about that in our Sunday school class and about marriage. That I think we've lost that in marriages, but I think it goes well beyond that. We've lost that in our churches, of people who are faithful and consistent to their duty to God and the relationship that they have with God. But he says here he was faithful. But then he goes on and he says, and you know what? It's interesting because of all that Tychicus went through, he had to be faithful. I mean, he saw the hardships that Paul went through. He saw Paul in prison. He saw Paul arrested in Jerusalem. And he saw all that, and yet he continued. It's faithful. But then it says there, he was what? A faithful minister. Now, that word may confuse you. Throughout Scripture, when we see the word minister, it's usually in connection with the apostles. Sometimes when you hear minister, you think of, you know, this guy. You know, the pastor is the minister. And that might give you the impression that Paul is putting Tychicus into the category of an apostle or a pastor. But he's not. In fact, the word that is used here is the same word that we see used in Acts chapter 6 when the apostles say, hey, we need to call out men. And the word that's used in Acts is deaconos, which is where we get the word deacon. And the word minister here is that same word. It's the Greek word deaconos, which simply means one who serves, or one who, it implies one who runs errands. It focuses on rendering assistance, often of humble and menial tasks, mundane activities, activities that would often seem to be without dignity. So when Paul says here he was a faithful minister, it's not that he's saying he was a faithful preacher, a faithful apostle, a faithful teacher. No, he's saying this guy was faithful to do the little things. He was faithful to, you know, he was the guy that was in church. He was the guy that did the small little task that was called on him to do. He was the guy that, you know, and there are people, and I'm going to single people out because I would embarrass them and leave someone out, but there are people in this church who faithfully do little tasks that no one sees. That was Tychicus. He faithfully served. He did what was asked of him to do. Let's go on to the next phrase, because I think these two can be linked together. He says, he was a beloved brother, a faithful minister, and a fellow servant. Now, fellow servant seems very similar to this minister, and in some ways it is a similarity. It's one is to serve, but this servant here is actually, it's a bond servant, a doulos. It's one who is bound to their master and must submit. The word here is often used of in the New Testament of one who submits to their master because of a greater obligation or a greater understanding of what the master has done. See, a minister serves out of love, which Tychicus is commended for doing, but a servant serves out of obligation, not in the sense of woe is me, I got to do this, but in the sense of love because of the debt that was paid by the master. And here, Tychicus is commended for both. Not just that he served faithfully, but he gave of himself completely. He submitted of himself completely to the master. He was one that was faithful and he was serving. In our own walk, are we that? Are we faithful servants? But then, next, I want you to notice the next one. A servant of God is available and willing. Continue on in the passage. Look at verse 8. I have sent him to you for this purpose. As I said earlier, Tychicus did many different things at the request of Paul by the will of God. This was not an apostle. This was not a man who was a missionary, though he did the work of one. He was a servant. He was a minister. This was a guy who was willing to do whatever was needed in the work of God. He was available. He was, you know, he was the guy that said, you know, whatever you need, I'll do. Paul, you need me to do that? Okay, I'll go do that. Paul, you need that? I'll go do that. I'm so thankful for my dad. I grew up in a Christian home. My dad was very involved in my church. And I often say that my dad is the type of guy that every pastor wants in his church, because he's the guy that will do anything he is asked to do. I think every church we've ever been in as a family, he's at some point been the chairman of the deacons, but he's also the janitor in every church we've ever been in. Okay? He's 75 years old and he still cleans his church. He's a Sunday school teacher. And I don't say this to brag on my dad. I say this because that's the example that I saw every day in my life. That a pastor would say, hey, we need someone to do this. And I, you know, and at times as a kid, it frustrated me. We'd be like, Dad, you know, can we stay home? And he'd be like, no. I remember when I was a senior in high school, and the church we went to didn't have a kids program. And my dad went to the pastor and said, this church needs a kids program. The pastor said, yeah, it does. Do you know someone who will lead it? And my dad said, I will. You know, and that's just the kind of example that I saw. I mean, he was the type that was, and still is, the type that is always willing, always available. You know, he's, as I said, he's in his mid-70s, and he'll send me an email and say, oh, we got this breakfast on Saturday for the women, and I'm cooking for it. Or we got this and going on, and I'm like, do you ever stop? No, I don't. Available. Tychicus was that type of guy. He was available. Paul says, I'm going to send him to you because it's what he does. It also says that Paul wanted Tychicus to inform them how he's doing. He was supposed to report on Paul's doings. I mean, this was the very one of the very first missionary reports. Okay? But Paul couldn't do it, and so he had to send a representative. Are you available? I am not saying this because I'm your pastor and I hope you'll do things for us. Although that may be what God wants you to do. I'm asking if you're open to do anything God wants you to do. Are you available? Are you available if God is asking you to serve your neighbor in some way? Are you available if God is telling you to give the gospel to your coworker? Are you available if God maybe even is saying to you, I want you to leave the comforts of your job and serve me full time? Are you available? I don't know, because we don't have the whole story. I don't know what Tychicus' career was. But that's not what we see. We see a guy who said, I'll go and do whatever you want me to do. Now, when's the last time, if ever, you've heard someone named Tychicus? It's not that someone we name our kids after, and yet, man, he's an example of someone that we should be following his example. He was a servant, and a servant of God is available and willing. Fourth, I want to look at, a servant of God is sensitive and encouraging. I love this. Look what it says in verse 8. I will send him to you for this very purpose, that you may know how we are. Okay, missionary report. Then look what he says next. And that he may encourage your hearts. There's so much to learn from that simple phrase. Paul was not just sending Tychicus because he was good at delivering letters. Paul was not just sending him because he was the best walker that Paul had in his midst. Not because he was a good navigator. He could figure out how to get there. No, because he was an encourager. And the word here literally means to come alongside. To summon. To hold someone up. It's the idea of giving aid. It's the idea of giving help, whether it's action or word. It's the idea of building up. Kent Hughes, who's an author, he describes it this way. I love this description. He said, I see this exemplified every time my church has a roller skating activity and the parents put their little ones on skates for the very first time. Mom and dad skate with their children, sometimes holding onto their hands, sometimes with their feet on the ground, sometimes even lifting them up in the air. But all the while, the parents are alongside encouraging. And that's what encouragement is. It's lifting up. When they fall, you're there to pull them back up again. It's a wonderful gift. And it's something that is required of every single one of us that's asked, is willing to be worn out in the process of encouraging. The English word encourage is interesting. I was studying this. It's derived from a root word that means with heart. Which, if you put it into the context of this verse, is interesting because what would that be then? He says there in verse 8, putting that in there, he says that he may with heart impact your heart. It's heart touching heart. There's no fakeness in that, is there? It's real. It's not a walking by someone in church on a Sunday morning and going, "How are you doing?" It's real. It's life impacting life on a daily basis. And throughout the New Testament, we are encouraged over and over and over again to be people who are encouraging. 1 Thessalonians says this, therefore encourage one another and build one another up. Can I give you a practical application, easy practical application for this message? This week, find three people to encourage. Three. It could be simply sending them a text message. Real quick. You know, this week I got a text message from someone. I didn't expect it, and it was a huge blessing to me. I was struggling, and pop-up text, "Oh, what's this?" And it totally changed my demeanor. It can be encouragement. It could be to call someone. Maybe you're not a text-type person. Call them on the phone. Could be that you pay them a visit. It could be that you go and purchase something small for them. It could be any number of different things. But everyone here, everyone in this room, everyone in your life, everyone you come in contact with needs encouragement. Don't just wait for people to encourage you. You say, "Well, you don't understand. I've had a bad week. I've had this go on, and I've had that go on, and I've had this go on." And you know what? You may need encouragement. And I hope that someone encourages you this week. But I want to challenge you. You encourage people. And here we see Tychicus was sent for the purpose, a number of different purposes, but he was sent. And Paul said, "Hey, I want him to encourage you. I want him to build you up." So, see, what is a servant? Loved and loving, faithful and serving, available and willing, sensitive and encouraging. Secondly, and we'll go through this quicker, but I want to look at the second guy mentioned in this passage. A guy by the name of Onesimus, the useful servant. Look at, if you will, verse 9. "And with him, with Tychicus, Onesimus, our faithful and beloved brother, who is one of you." Who is this guy? Who is this Onesimus that he's talking about here? Now, we learn most of what we know about Onesimus from Paul's letter to Philemon. Onesimus was a slave. He was bound by law to his master, and his master was Philemon. Now, this is not a discussion here about slavery, okay? We're not talking about that right now. But what we are talking about is who this guy Onesimus was. Onesimus ran away from his master Philemon. And because if he would have been caught, and you got to understand, in that culture, if Philemon would have been caught, he would have been taken back, and there could have been a number of ways he could handle it. He would have been reprimanded. He would have been punished. It could have been he was imprisoned. It could have been even he was killed. But he ran away. In the process of running away, he ran into Paul. I don't know all the details of how that happened, but he ran into Paul, and Paul was in jail. And so Paul says to Onesimus, "This isn't right. You got to go back." So Philemon does. And sent with him was probably this letter to Philemon to say, hey, you can read Philemon if you want, but basically Paul is saying, hey, take him back, treat him like a brother. And even so far as this, Paul says to Philemon in the passage, if he has stolen from you, if he has taken anything from you, I personally will repay you. That's quite a condemnation. Yes, he's commending them there. What do we learn from this? A couple things that I want to point out. First of all, God can turn the useless into usefulness. There's an interesting phrase in Philemon that I want to point out. You can read the book later. It's one chapter, so it's easy to read. But there's an interesting phrase in there. It says, referring to Onesimus, it says, formerly he was useless to you, but now indeed he is useful to you and to me. What does it mean to be useless? I mean, we've all at some point felt useless, haven't we? Paul is describing someone here who is useless. I was reading a book, and the author was talking about this idea of Onesimus being useless. And he said this, I want to read it, it's kind of an interesting story. He said, Onesimus is like a young man I met one time at a gas station. As I visited with him about his life, I learned that he was involved in the local high school marching band. I asked him, what instrument does he play? And when I asked, he looked down and he grinned and got kind of sheepish. And he says, I play the air tuba. The what? Apparently, this young man could not play an instrument. He couldn't even get a note out. But they needed the marching band to look bigger. And so they asked this young man to carry a tuba around in the marching band. But under no circumstance was he to even attempt to blow the horn. The young man said, I felt useless. That makes sense, doesn't it? But that was Onesimus' life. He was walking around life. No purpose. No music to speak of. All dressed up, but nothing to do. Paul says, but something changed. God changed him. We don't know the details of Onesimus' conversion, but we know at some point he came to Christ. It could have been with Paul. It could have been at some other point. But he came to Christ. And Christ changed him. And Paul says to Philemon in his letter, I'm going to send him back because he's now become useful to me. There's one of the things I want to point out is the amazing grace that was displayed by Paul. You say, what do you mean? Like I said, it's likely that this letter to Colossians was sent at the same time as the letter to Philemon. And in Philemon, Paul addresses Onesimus' faults and failures and what he did wrong. And he says to Philemon, take him back. But notice, how does Paul address him here? In the letter to the whole church, he doesn't say this. He doesn't say, hey, Tychicus brought along Onesimus. And, you know, he messed up, but, you know, take him back and kind of forgive him and be good. No, he doesn't. He doesn't even mention it. He says what in verse 9? Onesimus, our faithful and beloved brother. It kind of reminds me of the fact that, you know, as believers, we got to be forgiving. You know, everyone comes into this church with baggage. Now, maybe some have more than others. Maybe some is uglier than others. But everyone walks into this church with baggage, sin, failures. But we got to forgive. We got to love. Now, Onesimus was willing to repent. He was willing to change. And the proof of that is he was willing to walk these 1,300 miles to go back to his master to be, again, a slave in his master's home. That showed a change. But he commends Onesimus. The same way he did Tychicus for being a faithful, beloved brother. And he also even goes beyond that, because if you notice in verse 9, he says this, they will tell you of everything that has taken place. Not only does he send them back, not only does he call him a faithful and beloved brother, but he even tasks him with the job of being part of the report. And it shows us the second part is God can use anyone in his service. And this is just a great reminder how God can use anyone, whether you are young or old, rich or poor, no matter what, God can use you. God can use you in this ministry, in this church, in this world for his glory. What excuse have you made for not being a faithful brother in the Lord? Now, here's what I want to close with is this. What made Tychicus and Onesimus different? It was the gospel of Jesus Christ. If you're here today and you have never heard about the gospel of Jesus Christ, a simple explanation is this. The Bible tells us that every single person in this world is a sinner. Every single person in this world, because of our sin, is doomed for judgment, which the Bible tells us is hell. And every single person in this world, there is nothing we can do to escape that. Tychicus couldn't do anything on his own, and he was a good guy. Onesimus couldn't do anything. He tried, and nothing that we could do can save us. But it's only Jesus Christ. And when Jesus Christ comes into the heart and life of a believer, or of a person, we are changed completely, radically. The Bible tells us our old is no longer. And we come, as we've talked about through this whole book of Colossians, we get a new identity. We're changed. We're different. And that change is seen in the evidence of the lives of these two men. Now, let me ask you this question. Number one, are you here today? Have you placed your faith in Jesus Christ? Have you accepted the gospel? If you haven't, I challenge you to do that. Number two, if you have, has it radically changed you the way it has these two men? Has it? Is your life different? Are you a faithful servant of God? You should be, and I hope you are. Let's pray. God, we are thankful. We're thankful for the example of these two men. I know that you put these individuals in Scripture to teach us. I know for Paul, maybe it was just simply he wanted to write and tell about these men, but you have it here for a reason. And so we look, we see that these are example of two guys, one who seemingly lived for you completely, and yet he's an example of being an encourager, being one who is faithful. And we see another example of a guy who failed. He disobeyed. And Lord, yet he was changed because of you. Lord, I pray that you'll be with those that are here today. If there's any here that have not accepted the gospel into their life, they've not believed that they are a sinner and that they need you to escape hell, I pray that they will do that today. Whether it's someone who's been in church their whole life or someone who just walked in today. Lord, also I pray that you'll be with those that are believers. Is this gospel really impacting their life? The way that we see exemplified in these two individuals that we looked at today. And I pray that it is. Lord, we thank you again in Jesus' name. Amen.
Would you please stand together with us as we sing our final song this morning? 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus.
Just to rest upon his promise, just to know the same.
to have a few announcements. And before that, let's pray. Father, I ask that this morning you would give to us your grace. I ask that you would help us to be like Tychicus. I pray that you would help us to be like Onesimus. But Father, mostly I pray that you would help us to be as you call us to be through Jesus Christ and the power that he gives to us through the gospel. I pray that this morning as we leave from this place that you would give to us the ministry of encouragement to one another, to remind each of our brothers and sisters in Christ what you've done for us and how that changes our lives and our perspective, how that gives us the ability to bring glory to you through the little things that we do, how it gives us the opportunity to witness of the gospel to those who do not yet know, how it gives us the privilege to see people trust in that gospel, not through our power, but as the gospel brings the power through our faithfulness to bear upon their lives. And so I pray this morning that you would help us to have that privilege to be able to share with those who don't know and with those who know, that we might be encouragers. We lift up to you this morning Ruthie Newhouse with her procedure coming this week, that you would give to her grace in preparation for that. We lift up to you Sharon Correll as she is dealing with housing issue. I pray that you would give to her as well patience and encouragement, and we pray that you would work that out according to your will and for your glory. We lift up to you those who are not able to be with us, those who are shut in, those who are out of town, those who are ill today. Would you please give to them encouragement from your word, that they might also be encouragers, evidences of your grace, of the gospel. We pray that you would be glorified through this church, in this community, this week. In Christ's name, amen. You may be seated. Hey there, First Baptist. Let's talk about what's going on at our church. Nominating ballots for church officers for 2020 have been placed in church member boxes in the back hallway. Go ahead and take yours and fill it out and return it to the church office today. If you haven't yet, please sign up for a photo session for our new church directory. Photo sessions will be scheduled for November 6th through the 9th. Finally, if you're new here at First Baptist, we'd love to get to know you more. If you stop by our guest center in the annex, we have a gift for you as our way of saying thanks for worshiping with us. Have a great week, First Baptist.